welcome you back to Golf Talk of the Carolinas. John Hockaday, Daniel Naveau, and Doug Thompson here in the booth tonight. And we've got Jack Nance on the line with us, Executive Director of the Carolinas Golf Association. Jack, welcome to the show.
Thank you, John. Good to hear from y'all, Doug and Daniel as well.
Well, great to talk with you as well. I guess you're on your way back from the Walker Cup this weekend. Let's hear about it.
Well, I did make it back, and I got to tell you, when I got down there to Palm Beach and Seminole, I knew I wasn't in Kansas anymore. Oh, my goodness. That place is gorgeous, just the whole thing. And I've never been down there before. I know y'all or some of our listeners may have been. But it was just something else. It was great watching golf and not playing it because it was so difficult. But it was really, it reminded me so much of number two around the green complex of that golf course. But it was just fantastic to see all this and interact with all those players. And I did get sick.
You did not? I was. I guess a lot of the players got sick. Is that from food poisoning? Is that correct?
Yeah. That's what I was referring to. It was funny, about the same amount, equal amount on both sides of the GB and I and the USA got sick. And it was really technically a 24-hour bug, you know. And the ironic thing about this is that weeks before I went down, I got invited to go to do rules. So I was with a group every day and working the rules. And so part of the USGA's deal going down there was to create this bubble. So, you know, weeks prior, we got to get tested or make sure we're vaccinated fully and all this stuff. And we all take this incredible, great precautions to get down there. And then all of a sudden, within the bubble, there's another bubble of people getting sick.
Yeah.
And wow. I just thought, well, you know, the best laid plans are out there, but it doesn't always happen that way. And luckily, it was 24 hours, but I think people like Tyler Scarpacci and those guys really got impacted by it, having to play 36 the final day, and depending whether their opponent had it or not. So it was an interesting dynamic.
You know, I had an opportunity to watch some of it on TV this weekend, and I guess it was Saturday's matches coming up to the 18th hole, and it seemed like every match got to the final hole, and I kept watching balls roll off that green down the hill to the driving range tee. And I actually thought about you with that pin placement, how slick that was. But were you there? Were you able to see some of that? That was very difficult.
I was with Stuart Hagstead and William Mao the first day. And then I was able to do – when you're working rules, you're either with a group or you're out in front as an observer. And I did – I was able to get out in front of these groups and watch the balls. And it was actually really interesting to be up there and watching where the balls come down and how the wind would react to them. And exactly like that, I saw all that you're talking about, the balls, just like number two or any other course that might have these kind of crown-shaped greens, it stays on the cuspis, and it, you know, about 10 seconds later, it starts dribbling back, and 50 seconds later, it ends up, you know, 50 yards down at the bottom of a hill. Even with these great golfers, but the fact that the wind was out there and very much part of this really made it fun to watch. And it was just something to look at that ball striking. It's something else.
Could you play that particular hole, if you can help me describe that? Can you play that hole another way that ball wouldn't end up there? I mean, would any shot that got up there near the hole, if it were a bit long, was that the one?
I think you had to start it out in the ocean and hope that it didn't get too far to the right. So.
Oh, right.
And
oh,
that's so. A good, yeah, Doug referring to, there are places it's like, you know, it just, you have to judge the wind and trust that the wind's blowing from the coast over left to right. So the 17th and 18th holes are, you know, the wind's coming off the coast left to right. I guess that would be from the west, from the east, rather.
Right.
And you got to trust to hit it over what they call the sea grapes and hope it comes back. And then if there's not a gust, it's not going to. But the right side of 17, it was going off. The right side of 18, it was going off. And you can't, you know, from 200 yards out, you can't really control that. You just got to hope that Mother Nature and your swing cooperates. But that's what made it so fun to watch. and not suffer through it as a spectator, because you're just, you know, these guys, all these things are going through these guys' heads, and you're trying to say, hey, what would I do there? And well, it was really, really
good
fun
to know,
watch.
It's good to know what turns you on, Jack. So, you know what I mean? That's a little sadistic sort of like.
Yeah. Well, it is, but, you know, it's like you guys watch NASCAR. It's the same thing.
Well, you're right. That's good point.
Well, you got to see some good golf. I guess, what, 7-5 the score after the first day. They played all even on day two, so really a tight finish to that match.
It was, and they really got some good momentum. GB and I got some good momentum back in day two, which really is fun to make it interesting and not a runaway. And they were, you know, on paper, the Americans had a better team, but, you know, it never really counts until you put it on the, in the record book. And they stayed true. Stuart Hagestad was a great final guy and did his thing. And so it was fun. And just Seminole shined. And I'm glad they did it, because like so many things, people have heard about Seminole and maybe Pine Valley. And it was great to offer at least a view to the world what this place is about. And that's a great start for them.
You're right.
Well, it was absolutely beautiful. I didn't see every hole, but I saw, I guess, quite a bit of the back nine just watching some.
I'd like to know that was on.
Wow.
Was it Buttonheads with the tournament?
It was on Sunday morning as well, I think I saw some of that too. So, But anyway, let's talk a little bit about the Carolinas Golf Association now that you're back in town. I guess a lot of qualifiers right now going on.
Yeah, we've had some we're in the middle of U.S. Open qualifying. Local, that is, because for the listeners, for the men, there's a local and a sectional qualifying, and that sectional guys go into the championship. And for the women, there's also a sectional qualifying that a one-stop shop kind of goes into the championship. And we've had a couple of those. We're going to have some more, and another little tidbit I'll tell you in a second. But for the men's U.S. Open, we had one at River Landing, Spencer Oxendine from Fayetteville. Plays at North Carolina State. Great stick. He qualified. Jimmy Gillum from Myrtle Beach and Christian Salzer from Sumter, South Carolina, qualified at the River Landing site. And then the U.S. Women's Open qualifying, we had at Mid Pines. And you'll recognize these names: Lauren Stevenson from Lexington, South Carolina, who's already out there playing on the tour. She qualified. Gina Kim from Durham, Duke.
Yep.
And then Natalie Sheneveson. It's an interesting name, but if you can't read it or pronounce it, you'll know that's the one I'm talking about. She's from South Carolina, and she qualified. So we had three of the four girls that qualified. The fourth went to Furman, but she's not from the Carolinas. So it's always fun to have some of the people that are local that come in and qualify and go to the championship, because it's not always the case, and a lot of outsiders will come in and sometimes take up the spots. So two of those, and just one thing, the North Carolina Senior and the North Carolina Senior Women are coming up this week. The North Carolina Senior Women is going to be played at Highland Country Club over the next, I think, 7 to 10 days. I don't have the exact date. And then the men's North Carolina Senior begins at River Landing tomorrow with all the stalwarts that you and we are all familiar with, Paul Simpson and Preston Edmondson and all those guys. Yep. So should be a really good week for senior.
Who you got working the U.S. Open senior qualifier at Highland on the 24th? Because Daniel and I are over there.
Listen, yeah, Jack, there's two guys in his booth that are going to be qualifying down at Highland, and they'd love to talk to you about the pins and the tees some before y'all get down there to set them.
Well, you know, there's a price tag for everything, and it'll cost you.
Hey, and on a serious note, let me ask you this. You get paired with two other guys, and one guy is really, really slow, and your group gets kind of target. I feel like, seriously now, I've always come out of my game there trying to make up the slack, and it don't seem fair, you know? So does your observer document who's slow, or the whole group gets it? Or what's the deal there?
Well, I'll tell you this. This is all you got to live by as a golfer. If y'all get warned or whatever, all you have to do is hit your shot within 40 seconds, 48 if you're the first person hitting, and you got nothing to worry about. So don't, and I know where you're coming from, Doug, because if you get two regular golfers and a very slow one. The two regular golfers are just trying to make up time to keep your group up. And we don't want that. So what we're after is we're not going to penalize a group. We're going to penalize a person. So if you get warned, just make sure you hit your ball within 40 seconds and you got nothing to worry about.
All right, the warning comes to the group. Is that right?
It does. And then they'll normally say something like, all right, this group's got to pick up. We're going to watch y'all. And they'll watch all, let's say, three players. And if two of the players who are fast hit within 40 seconds, you got nothing to worry about.
Yeah, yeah.
But if the dragger is out there hitting in 50 seconds to 60 seconds, now we know who to go after.
I hear
so
you.
So that's really, I say. Just worry about your game and don't try and make up for anything else.
Yeah, I was kind of looking at Daniel as I said that. No, Daniel's not slow.
Easy, Tiger.
But no, I've been in that situation. And even in a golf that's not a tournament. You know, you get look back behind you, especially at my place, and I'm playing with a group, and I look back, and these guys are waiting on us. And I got a guy in my group that's plumb bobbing a nine, it's a bad feeling, and I feel myself playing faster to make the difference up. It don't seem fair, but I see how you're doing it now, and I feel a lot better.
Here's what I would suggest, and anybody out there playing in our tournaments, if you get your group gets warned, ask the person who comes up and you say, if I play within 40 seconds, am I going to be okay? And they'll say yes. And then you can just let it all go because I'm not worried about carrying the group.
Yep,
you just do what you got to do. And that, as a player, I like that because you don't have to worry about the group.
Yeah, there's no chance. I'd exceed 40 seconds because I forget what I'm doing.
Plus, maybe asking that question about the 40 seconds, maybe the guy that's playing so slow heard that question, and maybe he'll think about it.
That's the point, I guess.
And the good news for all this is I know exactly what to get you for Christmas, Doug.
A what?
Listen,
I'm going to tell you something. You ain't going to hear nobody, oh, Doug's up here playing slow. You ain't never hear that. No. That's not going to happen. It'd be a different Doug, I can tell you.
Well, Jack, we want to thank you for talking with us tonight. I know that was a great trip down to Florida, and I guess now you got to recuperate from that. But, again, we do appreciate the CGA and everything you guys do.
Absolutely.
Well, thank y'all for covering us, and it was probably my first and last walk the cup, but I had a blast.
Good for you, brother. I know you did. That was a beautiful place. Jack. Thanks, Jack.
Yeah, thank y'all. Appreciate y'all's support.
All right.
Take care.
That's Jack Nance.
Yeah.
With CGA. We are going to take a quick break and we'll come back, talk more golf right after this.